Hello everyone, welcome to the video lecture of Titlee solution 2022. In this video I'll be solving the questions of strength of materials. So let's get started. The first question of strength of materials is question number 63. It says the stress developed in a material at breaking point in extension is called Young's. The options given are breaking stress, fracture stress, point stress, ultimate tensile stress. If you look at the diagram of stress versus strain of mild steel at question number 65, so this is basically talking about this point, which is called breaking stress. So our answer will be option A. Question number 64. When the temperature of a solid metal increases, the options given are option A, strength decreases but ductility increases. Option B, both strength and ductility decreases. Option C, both strength and ductility increases. Option D, strength increases but ductility decreases. Strength is defined as the ability of a material to withstand load. So when temperature increases, the ability of a material to withstand load decreases, hence its strength decreases. And ductility is the property of a material by virtue of which it can be drawn into wires under the action of tensile force. So if we increase the temperature, its ductility increases. So our answer is option A. Strength of metal decreases but ductility increases. Moving on to question number 65. The stress strain curve for mild steel is shown in the figure given below. Choose the correct option referring to both figure and table. So in this question, we have to match the points with its correct name. So the first point we have is point P, which is the proportional limit. Then we have point Q, which is elastic limit. Then R is the upper yield point. S is the lower yield point, T is the ultimate tensile strength, and point U is the failure point. So our answer is option C. Moving on to question number 66. Two bars of different materials and same size are subjected to the same tensile force. If the bars have unit elongation in the ratio of 2:5, then the ratio of modulus of elasticity of the two materials will be. You know, changing length of a material del L is given by PL by AE, where P is the force, L is the length, A is the cross-sectional area, and E is the modulus of elasticity. So from here we can write E equals PL by A into delta L. Now the ratio of modulus of elasticity of the two materials is given by E1 by E2 equals PL by A into delta L of the first material divided by PL by A into delta L of the second material. Both the materials are subjected to same load, so PP gets cancelled, lengths are equal, cross-sectional area are equal. So what we are left with is E1 by E2 equals delta L of second material divided by delta L of first material, which is nothing but 5 by 2. So our answer is option B, 5:2. Moving on to question number 67. The stress at which elongation of a material is quite large as compared to the increase in load is known as, options given are yield point, ultimate point, rupture point, none of these. If you recall the stress strain diagram of mild steel, so this is basically talking about point R, which is the upper yield point. After this point, we don't need to apply any load. but there will be significant change in strain. So our answer is option A, yield point. Question number 68. The property of a material by virtue of which it can be beaten or rolled into place is called. The options given are malleability, ductility, plasticity, rollability. So this property is known as malleability. Question number 69. The shear force diagram of a cantilever beam of length L and carrying a uniformly distributed load of W per unit length will be. Let's say I have a cantilever beam and this is subjected to a UDL. W Newton per meter. The length of the beam is, say, L. Then the shear force diagram of this will be like this. If this is my zero line, then due to UDL, the shear force will vary linearly. This is the magnitude of maximum shear force, which is W into L. So this looks something like a right angle triangle. So our answer will be option A, right angle triangle. Now question number 70. The assumptions made in Euler's column theory is that the failure of column occurs due to buckling alone. The length of column is very large as compared to its cross-sectional dimensions. Option C, the column material obeys. Option D, all of the above. So this question is from the chapter Column and Strut. The answer will be option D, all of the above. All these three are the assumptions of Euler's column theory. Now moving on to question number 71. Positive bending moment is known as, the options given are hogging, sagging, ragging, inflection. If I have a beam which is initially straight and due to load, if the beam bends like this, then the bending is considered positive. And this type of bending is called sagging. And if the beam bends in the opposite direction, like this, then such bending is considered negative. And this is called hogging. So our answer will be option B, sagging. Question number 72. Number of points of contact flexure for a double overhanging beam. Point of contact flexure refers to the point where the bending moment changes its sign. Now, if I have a double overhanging beam like this, supported at this point and at this point. So up to this point, the beam is supported, and beyond this point, it is overhang at one end, and beyond this point, it is overhang at another end. So this is why this is called a double overhanging beam. So in case of a double overhanging beam, the maximum number of points of contact flexure is 2, which is option B. Question number 73. The inclined member carrying compressive loads is, say, if I have an inclined member like this, which is carrying compressive load at the end, so such type of structure is called a strut. And if the structure had been a vertical one like this, carrying a compressive load, then it would have been called a column. So our answer is option C, strut. Moving on to question number 74. A simply supported beam A of length L, breadth B, and depth D carries a central point load W. Another beam B has the same length and depth, but its breadth is doubled. The deflection of beam B will be dash as compared to beam A. It says a simply supported beam is subjected to a point load W at the center. So because of this point load, the deflection delta is given as WL square by 16 EI. Now the ratio of deflection of second beam to the deflection of first beam is given as delta B by delta A, which is equal to WL square by 16 EI of the material B upon WL square by 16 EI of material A. The beam is subjected to same load, so WW gets cancelled, 16 gets cancelled. The length of both the beams are same, so L square gets cancelled. Both the beams are made of same material, so EE gets cancelled. So what we are left with is I A by IB, which is basically the ratio of moment of inertia of material A to the moment of inertia of material B. The beam is of rectangular cross-sectional area. You know the moment of inertia of a rectangle is given as BD cube by 12. So BD cube by 12 of material A to BD cube by 12 of material B. The constants 12 gets cancelled. The depths of both the beams are same. D cube gets cancelled. So what we are left with is delta B by delta A equal to breadth of material A by breadth of material B, and that is given as 1 by 2. So our answer is option B, 1/2. Moving on to the last question, the relation between Young's modulus E, shear modulus C and Buck modulus K is given by. The relation between these three modulus is given as E equals 9kc by 3k plus C, which is option C. So that's all for now. Thank you for listening. See you all in the next lecture.